My name is Doig. I'm a data scientist at Cienti Analytics. I'm originally from Barcelona, but I'm currently living in Austin, Texas, in the US. And I'm doing a lot of Python and data science. So I tweet a lot about the latest things that are happening in the Python data science section. So it's probably being able to get those feeds. So also the slides are available at Speaker Day. So you can follow along and then have all the references at the end of the talk. So what's this talk going to be about? First, what's data science? Then we're going to talk about what's the state of Python for data science. And then we're going to see how we can get started. It's pretty much really like the guide I wish I had when I started doing data science and no one told me about it. And so like, being able to optimize all the time that I spend searching online for the right libraries, how are people doing things, and after several years of doing data science in Python, came up with like how what's a beginner guide, and where you can get started, and ask your questions. So first question: what is data science? So I really like Josh Wills was one of the original developers and data scientists at Caldera. And he defines it as a person who's better at statistics than any software engineer and better at software engineering than any statistician. He has a very good slide and video deck on what it is to be a data scientist with his experience at Caldera. But that's like, when we see a glass, some people see the glass half full, other people want to see it half empty. That was kind of a positive definition, right? Let's see one a little bit worse. Like, the person who's worse at statistics than any statistician and worse at software engineering than any software engineer, right? Then, like, there's this, like, 2D, right? Like, that's combining the math and statistics with programming or hacking. But really, then you have to apply it to some domain, right? It's not just those two fields, but like then there's like, what subject matter do you care about that you want to apply those skills to like ask a business, like solve a business problem, solve some kind of scientific question. So kind of bringing also this substantive expertise. And that's a very like common Venn diagram that people see. But then you go online and you start looking what are actually people looking for, data scientists looking for. And this is a job posting, and it's a true story I found. So if you go through this job posting, you see things like experience with R, SAS, with machine learning, knowing how to do natural language processing, time series analysis, experience with database management, coding experience with Python, Java, C++, big data, AWS, Hadoop, MapReduce, Hackbase, knowing how to do data visualization, Tableau, and then also some front-end development techniques like HTML, Django, D3, whatever, right? So really, if you look at all of those requirements from a job posting, you see that there's actually different fields that they're looking for, like things that have to do with machine learning statistics, things that have to do more with scientific computing, with distributed systems, with web development, and with BI and analytics. And they're not like unicorn, like who can know all that in like the depth to actually make something meaningful. So really data science is a team sport. And it's building the right team that allows you to really exploit what data science has to offer. And if we look at those different fields that we've mentioned, we have different players. We have these data scientists, modelers that are caring about modeling the data. We have people worrying about developing the fastest, the most reliable algorithms. We have people worrying about the architecture and how to build a distributed system that's reliable. People worrying about like what's the application you're going to build for your users, and also what reports, what metrics. You can track and follow. So it's really like this, all these fields combined to make data science, and not only that machine learning part. So if we look at the Python ecosystem, and in general, different ecosystems, we find a ton of libraries, and it's just growing and growing, nonstop. So why are we focusing on the Python ecosystem in this data science space? So Python is a general programming language. It's easy, and many people agree that it's fun to learn. It has a very rich ecosystem. We've seen like there's a ton of libraries, and those libraries are just like expanding and growing. Every day someone, you know, open sources a new deep learning algorithm. Google just did it recently with TensorFlow. You know, we have libraries coming up, new visualization libraries. It's really expanding. And that also makes it challenging to be able for users of those libraries to be able to track what's the right appropriate tool to use right now, what's the best tool available for me, what should I be learning, etc. There's a lot of like a good developer community and a large developer community compared to other programming languages. And there's a lot of good conferences like SciPy, PyData, you know, PyCon, EuroPython, that you can go and like have a lot of talks around data science and data science libraries. We have a like very mature scientific computing libraries that other libraries are built on top of them. It's good for glue, like what they call glue language. And that glue language also allows us to have a very diverse user. We have, you know, people like right now in this conference, we have talks about, you know, for sysadmins, for web developers, for scientists, for statisticians. So really, you know, all these diverse users that are having other different applications can actually, you know, speak the same language, and that's very powerful. And then like, actually when you start looking like what tools in the data science space allow you to go from just, you know, exploratory analysis to actually production, you don't have that many options. You know, people talk about R or MATLAB, but you know, R, how are you gonna integrate R into your web application? And then there's this like quote on the best thing about R is that it was written by statisticians, and the worst thing about R is that it was written by statisticians. And the other option you have MATLAB, which is not open, and you have to pay license fees. If we also look at job trends and we compare things like R versus Python for big data, statistical analysis, data mining, etc., we see like that recently really Python has taken off. And primarily it's because the, like all the amount of work in the development community that has been happening, which a lot of the models that were written in R are now available through Python libraries as well. So I gave this talk because I had three really good talks that I watched that really inspired me to give like some relation of what's happening right now, where to get started, things like that. And those three talks, the first one was one from Jake Vanderplas at SciPy this year. He gave a keynote. You can watch it. And kind of like seeing how all these layers that are built one on top of the other one make this ecosystem, and we're just getting more domain specific as we're building, you know, things like AstroPy or BioPython, etc. Another one that's also very good is the path of the PyData Ninja by Thomas Wiki. And it's also a very good talk on showing how you can evolve, you know, what different steps you can take to like becoming better at data analysis in Python. And then there's this other one from Rob Story from PyData Seattle this year. It asks this question. He says, I have data, it's July 2015. I want to group things or count things or average things or add things. What tools in Python are there available for me to use? And he goes through a bunch of different libraries, like starting from poor like standard libraries to like pandas, blaze, dask, ibis, etc. It's a very good talk as well. So this talk, you know, I cannot cover everything, and it's not going to be very technical in depth. It's more of like how, where do we start, how we get the general map, and then you know where you can get started and get in more depth. In several ways, in like talks that are going to be happening today and tomorrow at this conference, and then resources that you're going to be able to find online. So first we need to set up what do you need to like get started, right? Other options are also on the left, so you can, you know, also explore them. What ID, like what's going to be my development environment as a data scientist? You know, there are other options. I'm going to talk about Jupyter, but there's Spider, PyCharm, Atom, Rodeo, Sublime, depending on your preferences, what type of developer you are or data scientist. For things like data munging, we have pandas. For data visualization, bokeh. But there's also a lot of, you know, the data visualization libraries in Python. Matplotlib, Seaborn, Pixlib, Plotlib, Lightning. So we're ready. We're going to have a pandas talk on data structures beyond dicks and lists. Also in this room later today, another one on bokeh specializing. So to the, not right now, it's very convenient that my talk's the first one, because you're gonna be able to see like the, you know, the broad picture, and then in depth, each of these libraries, you're also gonna have a talk. So then you can actually enter into the more technical details. Also machine learning, deep learning, big data, everything's, we also have libraries to work on those in the Python ecosystem. One thing that, I hate the term big data. Don't say big data to me, ever. And let's change that term for more like, when people actually mean big data, they actually mean things like medium data, like, you know, your Excel, you know, program's gonna crash, okay? That's not big data, let's not exaggerate. And then a lot of things are being done with distributed computing, right? Like, it's that, that's the term. Right now, big data is the marketing for our marketing friends so that they can go and sell things. But really, you know, we're gonna talk more about medium data and distributed computing. So this last one, I don't think I'm gonna have time to talk because we have a lot to cover and not a lot of time. But also like giving like the broad overview and things, looking at like what applications can build with those types of libraries. Also, we're gonna, there's more, you know, deeper talks later today, like and tomorrow, with scikit-learn, also vehicles. And if I had more time, there would be other things that are interesting in the data science space, like how do you get data from the web, like with web scraping, or how you build workflows and pipelines for batch processes, you know, natural language processing and statistics. We also have some talks on those that can give you more. And if we had even more time, we could go into deeper things like scikit-image or audiograph, and also like, you know, as a data scientist, you might need some basic Django, Flask, you know, web knowledge in order if you want to extract, you know, build an application on top of some machine learning library, you know, to send, you know, to show to your users and display your findings. So let's go on navigating the different parts of the data science ecosystem. And these are kind of the libraries that we're going to talk about. So first setup, Anaconda is a Python distribution for data science and scientific computing that comes with Python, a bunch of Python packages for, you know, for that purpose, you know, NumPy, SciPy, scikit-learn, and a ton. And then Conda, which is the package environment manager that's going to make, you know, those packages available for you, available to install, to manage environments, to differentiate different projects so you don't have, you know, you can manage those dependencies well. So Conda is package and environment manager, it's language agnostic, so you can actually, it's more than pip because you can con install things like other languages, R, Scala, Java, and, you know, and Node, etc. It's also cross-platform, so you can, you know, work well on Windows, OS X, and Linux. And you can like con install specific versions of Python, so you can manage, you can have 2.1.3 in your same, in your own, you know, in your development environment. It's just switch depending on the project you're working on. You can also install databases like MongoDB. So both Anaconda and Conda are GitHub libraries that are free to use. You can just go download on the Continuum website. So there's Anaconda and then there's Miniconda. And Miniconda just comes with Python and Conda. So Anaconda comes with a bunch of packages. Maybe you don't need all of them. Maybe you need two of them. You don't want to download everything. You know, you don't have that much space. You don't want to waste that space. So you can just install Miniconda, which comes with Python and Conda, and then install yourself the packages that you want for your project. And that's a lightweight alternative. And also, you can download it for free and open source from that page. Very also a useful resource is this Anaconda page where you have all the packages that are available through Anaconda, with the license they have, the latest version, and whether it comes through the installer, so when you download it, everything, or if it does not come there, but you can con install separately and also download. So there's a bunch of packages there. It's also differentiated between the packages that are available through 2.7, 3.4, and 3.5. If you want to learn more, I wrote a blog post at the Continuum website for how to use Conda for data science, and I also gave a talk on how to do reproducible multi-language data science basically with Python and R in your workflow. The IDE, Jupyter. So how many people here are familiar with Jupyter? Okay, maybe half. So Jupyter is open source and a way of doing data science and scientific computing, and now can be used across 40 different programming languages. One of the main assets of the Jupyter is this Jupyter Notebook. That's a web application that allows you to write code as well as text and equations, visualizations, and you know, because at the end, data science is about storytelling, right? You have a problem, you want to tell like how you solved it and how you came to a solution, and you want to give it some context. And being able to write text, writing equations, being able to have interactive visualizations while you're doing that is very compelling. So how did we get to Jupyter and what is the current state of what efforts are being done around it? So we started with the IPython, the interactive Python computing. Then we added the the IPython notebook interface. Then there was the NV Viewer project where you can actually see static renderings from notebooks that you have on GitHub. So if you push something on GitHub and you just link, you pass your username and repository, you're going to be able to see those notebooks rendered. Now also GitHub has support for visualizing those notebooks on GitHub itself, but it doesn't render well some JavaScript. So NV Viewer still is kind of the one that does that well. Then realizing that we had two separate things, then the notebook and the kernels, then other people started developing more kernels for other languages and using the same notebook UI. So now we had people writing kernels for R, for Julia, for a bunch of different libraries, and using the front end notebook as well. So now that's why IPython notebook became Jupyter, and it stands for Julia, Python, and R. The three data science languages, but now there's more than 40. Then there's also temporary notebooks, that TM and B, that's also available through trijupyter.org, and that is just a temporary notebook that you can that spins off. It's currently hosted on Rackspace with a collaboration. So if you want to try something, you can just go to that page. It starts an instance for you. You can do some, whatever you want on the notebook. And then it gets destroyed after not using it. It's just something temporary, don't rely on it. Then became Binder, and Binder turns a GitHub repository of IPython notebooks into something that can be executed by your users. And it's powered by Jupyter and also Kubernetes. And it's very easy to use. You just go, you have a full GitHub repository full of notebooks, and you want to make it easy for users to test those notebooks. So you go to mybinder.org, and you tell them that your GitHub repo, if you have any dependencies that need to be built within your within your project, it can be none, it can be a requirements.txt, normal Python one, environment YAML, the one we use with Conda, or a Docker file. And then you can also attach other services like Postgres or Spark. They can also be need to be run in that within that notebook. And then it's that easy. Then you get this button in your that you can put in your README in your GitHub page that's called Launch Binder. When you click, that's going to spin a container for you with all the notebooks and all the dependencies and services that you've added. So then anyone can go and run those notebooks without needing a local installation. Another cool thing about notebooks that I always talk about, not a lot of people know about, is that it's very easy to convert from notebooks to slides. So if you start, this one is an example with an R notebook. So if you go and start a new notebook, there's this cell toolbar where you click and say slideshow. And then it's going to turn like this, type, slide types, on the right side. And you can click slide or subslide or notes, and that's going to be able to manage that. And writing this command in your terminal, you're going to be able to have render that notebook into a slide deck, and then you don't have to worry about doing presentations on Keynote or anything. And you have there your text and your executed cells. I think it's pretty cool. And then there's Rice, which is live reveal JS. So now that one's just a static version, but if you actually want to have a slide but at the same time write code, that's the one you want. It's also reveal JS slideshow, but you can actually execute cells while you're giving the presentation. usually it's very, very dangerous to do that. Some people like it. If you want to learn more, you have a great talk about Damien, who's the one who developed Rice. And then there's I also wrote a blog post on how to use Jupyter and Conda for R, if anyone's interested in also learning more about R. Data munging. The key library here is Pandas. It's open source. It has a very good data structure for data analysis. The main data structure is the Pandas data frame. That's two-dimensional, size mutable, with, you know, you have iterative tabular types, and you have label access both in rows and columns. And it allows you, you know, you can get information on your data frame and see what types you have, like what different columns, etc. And what's the memory usage? Sometimes it's interesting to know. It's very easy to like read, you know, CSV and import it to as a Pandas data frame. There's a ton of parameters that you can pass to read CSV, because read CSVs are very nice to deal with. Then you can explore data with Pandas very easily. You can, like, you know, for example, this is a data set on beer reviews. You can get beers that have alcohol by volume less than 5 and just return these 2 columns if you want. In one line, you can also, you know, less than 5 and time after June, or the review overall rating higher than 4.5, and build those things. And that makes it, you know, with just one line, you can do all those filterings, etc. And then there's a powerful group by, for example, if you want to group by beer style, and then get things like the aggregated mean on that group, like the beer style, and you get that. And there's much more to Pandas. It's very good for time series data. If you have missing values, there's like the resample, you have fill methods. You can compute things like the role mean. It also handles very good like time zones and time problems. And then for tidying your data, there's a ton of methods. These are the 5 that I think are most useful. There's a great tutorial by Jeff Reback on PyData New York, which just happened 2 weeks ago, on performance Pandas. And then another blog post about from Jake Vanderplas, also on doing Python and data analysis for bokeh. So bokeh, there's going to be a talk later today very specific on bokeh, and I'm just going to give like an overview. But there's a ton of libraries in Python for doing data visualization. There's matplotlib, seaborn, bokeh, plotly, lightning, pixly. I'm going to talk about bokeh. It's the one I'm most familiar with, but also think as powerful features to do data visualization, specifically the interactive part, and also the ability to share through the browser. So bokeh is this library that allows you to do like custom visualizations, you know, maps. It has in tools like the hover tool, zoom in, zoom out, being able to do like statistical charts, streaming and some animation, and then also building kind of dashboards. And the good thing is like you write, everything you write is Python, but the program is able to output a JSON, then bokeh.js, which is a library that the bokeh developers have developed and then have written the JavaScript for you, so you don't have to. It's that JSON is the one that knows how to render those models into your browser. So you write a little Python, and then it outputs all the HTML, whatever you need for that display in the web. There's a bunch of charts, so it's easy to, and it's well connected now with the Pandas data frame, so if you have a data frame, you can pass it to a chart, and then have one of these. And then it's an HTML page, and it's static, so you can send it to anyone. It can also be rendered inside a NyPython notebook. And if you have a you know, an application, you can also have a bokeh web server where you can actually store all the plots you have, and then just pass an identifier in the page you want to be able to render those. So there's a good tutorial by Brian and Sarah, who are like developers that continue working full time on bokeh. And also, we're going to have a talk later today, so I would, if you're interested in data visualization, I would encourage you to attend. Scikit-learn, so machine learning, that's the new hype, right? So really machine learning, there's two types of, usually people classify machine learning in two types, supervised learning and unsupervised learning. Supervised learning is when you want to kind of predict something. You either have a categorical variable, you know, a class, or like a quantitative value, like a number that you want to predict what's going to be the, you know, for an unseen user or an unseen thing, what's going to be the value for that. And then there's unsupervised learning where you don't really want to predict anything, but you kind of want to see how things group together, what the, you know, either any kind of latent variables or structuring your data that you want to find, and that's how it's called unsupervised learning. So an example of unsupervised learning, imagine you have, you know, different people with different ages and genders and jobs, and you kind of want to see how your different users are grouped by some, you know, similar, that are similar in some way, and you want to have that exploration. You will do unsupervised learning and things like clustering. If you then want to see if that user is, you know, going to click to an ad or not, and predict whether, you know, who's going to be buying or clicking ad, something like that, you would want to do classification. If you then want to see how much money a user would spend on your site, that's the regression problem. So scikit-learn is the place to start if you have any of those problems or you want to start exploring any of those problems. It has a very nice and clean API. So just a very small example, you load, you know, a data set and you decide what model you want to use. There's many different models. You can go and like go deep in understanding of each of these different models. But for now, just think of like you have a model. It can be decision tree, classifier. It can be logistic regression, whatever, and the parameters that go with them. Then you fit that model into your data. The data is separated into the data and the target. The target is the thing you want to predict. And then you have the expected, which is the ones you already know, and the predictions that the algorithm is making for you. And then you can see some metrics on, you know, a classification report on seeing how well your model is. And this is kind of the basic structure of all models that you're going to have. And you're just going to change the models, the parameters, and then maybe do some what's called group search to find the most optimal parameters for your different models. There's a very good tutorial on scikit-learn from Jake Vandenfels and also Andreas Mirror that you can find on GitHub. Deep learning. So that's also the new hype, right? Everyone's talking about deep learning. I'm going to have like a 5-minute introduction of what neural networks are. So if you don't understand anything, don't feel bad about it. It's okay. I think there's a very good talk that Xavier Rufat gave at Pi Barcelona on understanding neural networks with no code and no math. And I stole a couple of slides because I thought it was really good. He gave it, I think it was like 30, 45 minute talk or longer. I'm gonna do it in 5 minutes, so don't lose me here, okay? So pretty much, imagine a classification problem. The most typical example is always like digit number, handwritten numbers recognition. So knowing like if something, if an image is a 1 or a 2 and a 3, and that came from trying to automate the letters, you know, people sending letters, and being able to do that classification of, you know, in the post offices automatically, you know, that would save a lot of time. Imagine if like you had to like for each one of the handwritten like letters that came in the U.S., someone had to classify them manually to understand the letter there. So that was one of the biggest you know, pushes to automating that. So you want some kind of algorithm that's able to like know what numbers are there, like, you know, zip codes, postal codes. So this neural network, imagine like a bunch of layers. Each layer, I don't know if you've seen it, but it's kind of like this graph with a lot of, you know, usually it's like arrows and dots. And you just kind of think each neuron is someone that's learning a specific pattern. And there can be a lot, right? There can be a lot of neurons in one. You can see a little bit better there. It's learning certain patterns that is not really one number, but it's like a representation that a number can have. There are some that are more specific to one, like you can see sixes, maybe a 7, a 5, an 8. But really, like a specific pattern, but that pattern can belong to different type of numbers. But when you combine them one to like next to another one, and you superlay and say, oh, if you have this, you know, certain pattern and this other one, we combine them, the most probable number that it's going to be is going to be a 5 or a 4. And you get those probabilities, and then you assign those probabilities to the number. So you can see, for example, one of those neurons is finding this curving pattern. You cannot see very well the color here, but there's different colors. You might see it better when you have the slides on the PDF on speaker desk. But it's funny, like you can see that, for example, this the first one, there's a curvy, like half of the 0, half of the 3, the 5, the 6, the 8, all have these like in the shape. Then you have these like vertical things. It can be a 1 or the 2 or the 4 or the 7. If you combine a lot of different patterns, one after the other one, if you superpose, imagine you superpose several of those, kind of you're going to see through the number that's most probable being. So imagine this, you have a lot of different patterns, you combine them all, they both decide what's the most probable, and then you finally find that this one's most probably a 4, but then if you also have a high, like 31% chance that that's a 4, but then you have 21% chance that that might be 9. And they said it will find the probability and you find the maximum for them. So what things you can do with neural networks and deep learning? So this is a very cool example. You have the notebooks underneath, so you have all the Python code that you need to replicate these examples. And this is like neurons that learn art style. And this was something that came out in a paper this summer. So imagine you gave, you know, a picture. The algorithm, this picture, and a style. It's able to convert your picture to that art style. And there's a lot of, like, I think that there were plenty of, like, different Barack Obama's pictures in different art styles. So if you Google that, that's a neat, you can see, you know, combining those styles and seeing how the algorithm learns how to replicate and change. So we've seen the image recognition problem. There's also an example here in how you can use theano and lasagna to do that solve that problem. And then this also is a fun one. An algorithm is able to distinguish between waffles and pancakes. So there's also the notebook example there. And you don't see it very well, but on the top left corner of this image, there's a class that the algorithm predicted and the real label. And it does a pretty good job of, you know, distinguishing between what's a pancake and a waffle. There's all these materials come from a tutorial at Pydia New York in 2015 that they have 2 weeks ago by Evan Wilson. And if anyone's interested, I think it's a very good introduction to both libraries. So what to do next? So now you've gone through this very speed, like 30-minute introduction to all of this. I have a lot of like favorite blogs. The first one is the one that I'm maintaining, so that's why it's the first one. Then Matt Robin has very good blog posts as well. Daniel, Jake Randall-Pass. And then we have like our developers writing blog posts. There are a bunch of also startups in the US that now have data science teams that share what they do on like a weekly basis, and it's very interesting. There's nerds.airbnb.com, and they like, you know, share their open source projects and they write about them. The one Airflow, one I mentioned before, was open source by Airbnb. Y-Hat has a very, very, very good, that's probably the best in the list for data science. Stitch Fix also has, Stitch Fix is this startup in the US that does clothes styling for people, like they send you a box with clothes. And they have a good one on finding clothes styles for people and seeing how to match someone's style. And then Spotify also has a lab that Spotify has come and also have a lot of good technical and data science. There's a lot of conferences like Python, your Python, then more specific like sci-fi, your sci-fi for scientific computing, but very related. There's the PyData conferences that happen, you know, I don't know how many we had this year, but there are more coming next. They're all over the world. I think this year they were fighting in London, Berlin, and they're, I don't know if Amsterdam. Then in Spain, we have a lot, like Python in Spain here, like we have a track, so you have a great opportunity. Python times about to talk, and talk. And your Python is going to be next year in Bilbao. So it's also a great opportunity. Python video is where you can find all the talks of all conferences related to Python, indexed by, you know, conference and topics and things like that. Very well, like, you know, to search if you want a tutorial on pandas, to search their pandas, and you find all the tutorials that people have been given on pandas. And then the PyData TV channel on YouTube also have all the talks from PyData conferences. It's also very, very good. Another recommendation, find a local Python meetup near you, and if there's no one, start one. And that's it.